is a river, and goodness flows. There is a fountain that drowns sorrows. There is an ocean deeper than fear. The tide is rising, rising. There is a current stirring deep inside. surrounding the sanctuary. We're not here just alone. There's angels unaware that we're entertaining. Oh, thank you, Lord, for that open place this morning. There's angels just surrounding. We're not worshiping alone. So Lord, we do. We enter into your song and your sound this morning.
Stars they wept, the morning sun was dead, the Savior of the world was fallen, his body on the cross, his blood poured out for us, the weight of every curse upon him.
Forever he is glorified, forever.
We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb is overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah.
Come on.
We sing hallelujah.
Today in your own life, the stone has been rolled away. The grave is open. You can come out now. The King is alive in you. He's risen in you. And it's time to come out of the grave that you've been in. Hey, the stone has been rolled away. Oh, he's alive. Now forever. Many times when we have places that are open, but we have other places that are still shut. And the Lord's just speaking this morning. He wants to go to every place. He wants you to be wide open to him. He wants to give you everything and more. But he can't do it when the grave is closed, when the doors are shut and locked. So, Father, we do allow you to come in this morning. And we put the key under the door. We say, open the door, Father. You can come in now. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Thank you.
wonderful name it is. Well, nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus. You didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus, you brought. Sin was great, love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. Wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. Jesus, but death could not hold you, the veil tore before you, silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring, the praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again. Name it is. Oh, nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. So much power in your name. So much power in your name. All this power in the name of Jesus. Power in the name of Jesus. We speak your name. We speak your name. Hey. Just play the song of the Lord, guys. Hallelujah. Jesus. Jesus, we exalt you in this place. Lord, we exalt you in this place. Hallelujah, we exalt you, Father. Everything that you are, everything that your name declares, we exalt you in this place. So you're worthy, King, worthy of all honor, all power, all glory.
My friend and King, anointed. safe refuge, my treasure, Lord, you are my friend and king, anointed when most holy. I will exalt you, I will exalt you, I will exalt you, you are my God.
Yeah. Hallelujah. There's just a sweet spirit in the room. There's just like this, just kind of like, ah, God, you're just so awesome. Ah, hallelujah. Let's just bring up our supernatural kids while we're in this. You've been ready for this all morning, haven't you? She's been ready for this all morning, and you're barefoot. Okay, Mom, it's snowing outside. Thank you, Jesus, for our supernatural kids, coffee-drinking supernatural kids, apparently. Hallelujah. Bless them as they go. You've been ready for this. She walked in the door this morning. She's like, when's kids church? She's ready to go. So go bless them. Bless our teachers today. Good morning. You are dismissed. You are dismissed. You are dismissed. Everybody came out in the middle of our blizzard today. I know, this crazy New Yorker doesn't know what what 1 inch of snow does to Carolinians, but that's all right. Everybody's staying home in caution. Oh, my gosh. So welcome to those of you who are here, the rest of you who are watching online. Welcome, welcome, welcome. So a couple announcements. This guy named Todd Bentley is actually going to be coming back to town. He's been on a California and Alaska tour for the last 6 weeks. He will be here this Wednesday. I can always tell when Todd's getting ready to come back into town because my phone starts blowing up with to-do lists. And so he'll be back in town this Wednesday. He'll be gone for the weekend, and then he'll be back in town actually for the 22nd as well. And you may have gotten, as you came in, a little notification. Todd always likes to mingle and have food, so we're going to do a pre-service barbecue. And so I will provide the hamburgers and fixings for the hamburgers if you guys will bring any side dishes that you want to bring for that Wednesday the 22nd. We'll start around 6:30 with the barbecue, and then we'll start worship around 7:30 or so. But we'll get a little bit of time to hang out. And Todd's been gone for a while, and so he wants to see everybody and hang out. So that'll be a good night for that. And now that the time changes here, we'll have some sunshine and probably some decent weather. So anyway, so we're excited about that. But these next two Wednesday nights, Todd is going to be here, and he's ready to go for it. So stay tuned, stay tuned, stay tuned. Yeah, and that's all I have for announcements. So hallelujah. We're really blessed. Oh, there is one more announcement. You might have noticed as we come back in, as you came in today, there's a lending library at the back table. I kind of did some rearranging, and I found a whole bunch of books that were in the closet, and so I put them back there. If you guys want to take a book or borrow a book, actually borrow a book because I'd like them back, but borrow a book to read. There's a lot of great resources by a lot of amazing authors, so make yourself available to that as well today. So hallelujah. Well, we're blessed to have Constance here today. Thank you, Jesus. Honored to have her here ministering all the time. Everything she does around here, so I'm going to give this to you.
All righty, good morning. We may be few, but we are mighty. Amen? Come on. And we welcome the online viewers today. We are so thankful that you're joining us from all over the world. You're not dealing with snow, so you're all up and ready and excited about what God's going to do today. So we are welcoming you and thanking you for being a part of Secret Place Church and always, always tuning in with expectation. So thank you, Lord, for the online viewers. And thank you, Lord, for the mighty army of God that is in the house. Amen? And those that are watching from home, even in our own local district, we bless you today and say have fun as you snuggle up in your easy chairs watching. All righty. So right now I am going to do the honor of taking the offering. It is a honor because it's a continuation of worship, and it is a privilege. It's a privilege to give unto the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the one and only, the one who gave it all. And we get to bless him with our tithes and our offerings. And so I have a scripture today, and it's from 1 Corinthians 4, and it's verse 6 through 7. And I will read it for you. It's, "For God, who said, 'Let light shine out of darkness,' made his light shine in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Christ. But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us." Hallelujah. We have this treasure in these earthen vessels. Just picture a treasure chest sitting on the inside of you, filled with gems, overflowing. And yet those gems are so invaluable, there's no money that could even purchase them on this earth. No money. And one of our songs today said that you are our treasure, Lord. You are our treasure. We are rich in Christ. And this verse goes on to say that he has shown His light has shone out of darkness in us. Let that light shine out of the darkness in us and give us the light of the knowledge of the glory of the Lord. We are glory carriers. We carry the knowledge of the glory of the Lord. And it says that we are in the face of Christ. We are in his face. You know, we're tattooed on his hand. He has our impression on his hand. And yet the word of God says in the Psalms that his eye is upon us at all times. Even when we sleep, he counsels us in the night. Whew! I think he's kind of stuck on us. What do you think? I think he's sweet on us. So he is our all-sufficient one. So I just encourage you today to reach down into that treasure chest that already resides within you. Ask Holy Spirit, what would you have me bless the King with today? What would you have me just throw back to the Master in such a willing, excited, happy way, because I am alive forever. I am alive forever. This is not a now thing. It's forever and ever and ever. We are alive forever in Jesus. So Holy Spirit, come. Touch those online. Touch those in the house. And those online, there is a blue button that you can press and you can donate right from your computer. There's also offering envelopes in the back of the chairs, and there's also an app that you can, and what's the app? Secretplace.com, right? No, just Secret Place app. Okay, Secret Place. So there's many ways that you can just make it happen. So Lord, we just thank you right now for that. You are going to just be glorified in our giving, because we're worshiping you back from the wealth you've given us, which is immeasurable, totally immeasurable, because we have the King, the treasure himself in our hearts. So we bless you, Lord, with our tithes and offerings today, and we want you to be glorified. And use it, Lord, for the kingdom advancement. We want to see the kingdom advanced on earth as it already is in heaven. Amen? All righty, so the ushers can come up with their buckets, and we'll... journey today? I hope the answer is yes. All right. We're going to talk about modern day Daniel. And in order to do that, we're going to go to the book of Daniel. I mean, I said that wrong. Well, yes, I am talking about modern day Daniels, but I'm also talking about modern day Babylon. Modern day Babylon. Okay, so we all know that Babylon was a wealthy pagan city that was ruled by a king named Nebuchadnezzar. And he was a very prideful king, and his journey is interesting. But as they came in and overtook King Jehoiakim, I think you say Jehoiakim, the king was overtaken by Nebuchadnezzar, and he took the king and his people into his hands and took them back to Babylon. So he came in, sieged them, and took them off. And Daniel and Hananiah and Mishael and Azariah, who all came into different names later, those were the Hebrew names, were chosen to serve the king in a three-year training process. They were young men of wisdom, possessing knowledge, and quick to understand. And we're starting in Daniel 1. Oh, I got to get there myself. I am not there right now. Yes. Okay. So we're starting in Daniel 1, and we're talking about the siege, and we're talking about Nebuchadnezzar coming in and overtaking and taking these guys back. So, you all know the story. As it goes, the king appointed a daily provision of king's delicacies and of the wine which he drank, that at the end of the time, it's like a three-year period, that they would serve before the king. So they were in a progression of being made ready and trained to serve the king. Okay? And in Daniel 1, 8 through 9, He purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of the king's delicacies, nor the wine he drank, and requested of the chief eunuch that he might not defile himself. Now God had brought Daniel into the favor and the goodwill of this chief of the eunuchs, and he sought him to ask if they could be kept from that rule, and he asked if they could just eat vegetables and water. They did not want to be defiled. They did not want to be defiled by the customs of the land or what the land had to offer. So he goes in there and he asks if he can be spared. So he gets that eunuch a little nervous, to be honest, because he's like, you know, buddy, the king can chop your head off for this request. But he says, well, give us 3 days, or I think it was 6 days, actually. Give us some time and let us try it out. So let's go there. It's 8 and 9, Daniel 1, 8 and 9. Oh, here it is. It's actually verse 10, 12. Please test your service for 10 days and let them give us vegetables to eat and water to drink. And then let our appearance be examined before you, and the appearance of the young men who eat the portion of the king's delicacies. And as you see fit, so deal with your servants. So the eunuch consented and in that matter and tested them for 10 days. And at the end of the 10 days, their features appeared better and fatter in flesh than all the young men who ate the portion of the king's delicacies. Thus the steward took away their portion of delicacies and wine that they were to drink and gave them vegetables. So as for these four young men, God gave them knowledge and skill in all literature and wisdom, and Daniel had understanding in all visions and in dreams. So you see what happens when you don't get caught under the principalities and the powers, because we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, powers, rules of darkness, of wickedness in high places. And there are certain rulers that have little imps and demons that walk around on the earth and want to trip us up, and they have one job, and it's to kill, steal, and destroy. That's the only job they have. So Daniel wasn't willing to come under that principality where he was now living, and he was staying straight in the face of God and in those around them. So then we go down to verse 11. Oh, I just read that, 11 and 12. Go down to verse 19. I told you we were on a journey. Then the king interviewed them, and among them all, none was found like Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, or Azariah. Therefore, they served before the king. And in all the matters of wisdom and understanding about which the king examined them, he found them, listen to this, they did it for 10 days, he found them 10 times better than all the magicians and the astrologers and who were all in his realm. Thus Daniel continued until the first year of King Cyrus. So they really found favor. They had proven their point. So that was the first place where they found favor with this king. So let's talk about the fact that they found this favor. In our day, Babylon, because we live in a modern day Babylon, there's not a whole lot different going on here, guys. And Babylon can only be overcome by God's people when the biblical boundaries for truth, ethics, morals, and doctrines are down. They are no longer adhered to. When boundaries are absent, then intimacy with God takes second place. The food and the wine of Babylon, i.e. today's atmosphere, the food and the wine of today, like Babylon, entices the spiritual taste buds, emphasizing experience, position, wealth. And what it does is it numbs our discernment, and this seductive means dissolves spiritual identity in Christ. Whoa! It dissolves the spiritual identity in Christ. Why? Because we end up looking like the world, acting like the world, getting entrapped by the world, and we aren't distinguished anymore as to who we are and that we're any different. So we have to understand that nothing's changed. It's not any different today than it was in Daniel's day. We have an enemy that's just using the same bag of tricks, and he's out to get us. All right. So let's go over, let's keep on moving. We're going to go to chapter 2, and in verse 1 through 3, we see there that again, it's the second year of King Nebuchadnezzar, and yet in verse 3, he has a dream, and his spirit is anxious to know the dream. And he's very interesting here. He demands that all his magicians and his astrologers and all of his sorcerers and all the Chaldeans tell him the dream and interpret it. Now, the thing that makes it interesting is he won't tell them what it is. He's demanding that they tell him what it is and that they interpret it. So they are freaking out. They're saying, what? They respond and tell him, you tell us the dream and then we'll interpret it. But he's very strong on it. He answers and says, nope, my decision is firm. Let's read that. He goes, so interesting. He says, my decision is firm, in verse 5, if you do not make known the dream to me and its interpretation, you shall be cut in pieces and your home shall be made an ash heap. However, if you tell the dream and its interpretation, you shall receive from me gifts, rewards, and great honor. Therefore, tell me the dream and its interpretation. And they answer him again. Let the king tell his servants the dream, and we'll interpret it. So this makes him even madder. So the king says, I know for certain that you would gain time because you see that my decision is firm. If you don't make known the dream to me, there is only one decree for you. Woo, he was a tough one. Only one decree for you. For you have agreed to speak lying and corrupt words before me till the time has changed. He wasn't putting up with their junk. He wasn't putting up with their funny business, if you will. Because he knew that they would put on a facade and try to make him understand. So he just cut through. Therefore, tell me the dream, and I shall know that you can give me its interpretation. Again, in verse 10 through 12, the Chaldeans answer the king, and they say, there is not a man on earth who can tell the king's matter. Therefore, no, king, look. No king, no lord, no ruler has ever asked such a thing of any magician, astrologer, or Chaldean. It is a difficult thing that the king requests, and there is no other who can tell it to the king except the gods, whose dwelling is not with flesh. Isn't that interesting? They're acknowledging that their God is the only one that they think that can do it, but he didn't dwell with flesh. We have a God that dwells in our flesh. Hallelujah. Amen? So, the king is angry and furious and gives this command to destroy all the wise men of Babylon. All, which of course includes Daniel and his three friends. So the decree went out, and they began killing the wise men. And they sought Daniel and his companions to kill them. We're down to verse 14. Then, with counsel and wisdom, here's Daniel. With counsel and wisdom, Daniel answers Arioch, the captain of the king's guard, who had gone out to kill the wise men of Babylon. And he answers him and says, why is this decree from the king so urgent? And then Arioch made the decision known to Daniel. So Daniel went in. Now, catch this. He knows he's already got favor with the king, and he just goes right into the king. Now, you understand how dangerous that is. But Daniel just walks right in to give, he walks in to the king and asks the king to give him time that he might tell the king the interpretation. Then Daniel went to his house with his friends, and they all had a prayer meeting. They literally did. They had a prayer meeting, and they sought the Lord for the mercy of God concerning the matter, that they may not perish. Go down to verse 19. Then the secret was revealed to Daniel in a night vision. So the first thing that Daniel does when that secret is revealed to him is he goes right to the source. This is so the way we need to do life in Jesus. He goes right to the Lord and he says, blessed be the God of heaven. And he answers and says, blessed be the name of God forever and ever, for wisdom and might are his, and he changes the times and the seasons, and he removes kings, and he raises up kings, and he gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to those who have understanding. He reveals deep secrets, verse 22. He knows what is in the darkness, and light dwells with him. I thank you and praise you, O God of my fathers, that you have given me wisdom and might. And now you have made known to me what we asked of you, for you have made known to us the king's demand. Do you see the teamwork there? Do you see how he knew that they needed one another to get that job done? And so he just goes right to the Lord, praises him, acknowledges him, and settles the matter right there. And basically, if you reread that, he prophesies what's going to happen through the next two kings too. He really does. Oh, what a mighty man. What a mighty man of God. So then he is brought up to the king. He's brought before the king, and he says, verse 27 now, I could have summarized this, but I don't want to miss how amazingly Daniel did this. He was just amazing, and I want you all to become Daniels. Okay, Daniel answered in the presence of the king and said, the secret which the king has demanded, the wise men, the astrologers, the magicians, and the soothsayers, cannot declare to the king. But there is a God in heaven who reveals secrets. Woo! Hallelujah. He has made known to King Nebuchadnezzar what will be in the latter days. Your dream and the visions of your head upon your bed were these. As for you, O king, your thoughts came to your mind while you were on your bed about what would come to pass after this. And he who reveals secrets has made known to you what will be. But as for me, the secret has not been revealed to me because I have more wisdom than anyone living. But for our sakes, note that he keys in who they are, chosen people of God. It wasn't even for the king's sake. It's for the people of God that he brought to serve that king. And that's why God has revealed this secret. We need to see that this is how God esteems us and holds us in higher esteem. And we are very precious and very special. And there is none like us. We are a chosen people of God. And he makes it known right there to the king. He says, but for our sakes, who made known the interpretation to the king, and that you may know the thoughts of your own heart. Whoa, that's putting it right on the line, isn't it? I'd say so. So here's a key with what Daniel was operating in. He was one who maintained humility, and he remained always dependent on the Lord, which is true humility. Therefore, he began to shine like a bright star in the darkness that surrounded him. And that's God's desire for us, that we be the bright, shining stars of God, even though we are amidst a modern-day Babylon. Amen? Hallelujah. So, we fast forward to Daniel 3, 46, 49, where Daniel turns, he tells the king the whole dream, and then in 46 and 49 of 3, chapter 3, Daniel says, he tells the dream, and then the king turns around after he tells him the dream. And what does the dream do for him? His pressing into God, his and his three friends pressing into God and showing the king who the God is and what that dream meant, because it was talking about the future of this nation and what was going to happen to it. The king turns around and goes, in 46, then the king, Nebuchadnezzar, fell on his face. Catch this. This is the king falling on his face. Prostrate before Daniel. This is unheard of, y'all. Unheard of. He falls prostrate on his face before Daniel and commanded that they should present an offering and incense to him. And the king answered Daniel and said, truly, your God is the God of gods, the Lord of kings, and a revealer of secrets, since you could reveal this secret. Then the king promoted Daniel and gave him many great gifts, and he made him ruler over the whole province of Babylon and chief administrator over all the wise men of Babylon. Wow, what a promotion. Why was he promoted? Because he was a man of an excellent spirit. He was known to have the Holy God and the spirit of the Holy God dwelling within him. He had an excellent spirit upon him. Whew. So Daniel petitioned the king, and he set Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, their new names, over the affairs of the province of Babylon, but Daniel sat in the gates of the king. Wow. What a promotion. Wow. You know what? This is a real interesting story of what it takes when you know God so intimately. And you are so favored by him because you know his heartbeat and you know the way he operates. And you press into him. First of all, he didn't get moved that they were going to have their heads chopped off. He just said, wait a minute. Let's think about this a minute. And so he sought counsel and wisdom, and he went. He went right in to the king without any hesitation and said, just give me a little time. And the king already knew what he was made of, and he gave it to him. It was awesome. So then he gets this promotion. But then after that, the king really makes a big, huge mistake. In chapter 3, he makes an image of himself. And it's quite a gigantic image. And then he makes a decree that after he makes this image, everybody in the province is going to bow down to it. However, we have these three Hebrew boys, now named Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They will not bow. They will not bow down. And it is brought to the attention of the king. So let's go to chapter 3, verse 14 through 18. They're in a heap of trouble, but they're not in God's eyes. In God's eyes, they are right where he wants them. So, 14 through 18. I'm trying to find where 14 starts in this book here. Oh, here it is. So Nebuchadnezzar speaks to them, saying, "Is it true, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you do not serve my gods or worship the gold image which I have set up?" And he starts to bargain with them a little bit. "Hey, guys, I really like you, you know. Let's try this again." Verse 15. "Now, if you are ready at the time you hear the sound of the horn, the flute, the harp, the lyre, and the psaltery, in symphony with all kinds of music, and you fall down and worship the image which I have made." Good! Exclamation point. Good! He's trusting they're going to do this. "But if you do not worship, you shall be cast immediately into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. And who is the God who will deliver you from my hands?" Oh, my goodness. Was he a little arrogant? Was he a little stuck on himself? I think so. So Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered, and they said to the king, King Nebuchadnezzar, "We have no need to answer you." Whew. I mean, seriously, that's strong. "We have no need to answer you in this matter. If that is the case, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the fiery furnace." Woohoo! He's able. He's able. "And he will deliver us from your hand, O king. But if not," I love this part, "but if not, let it be known to you, O king, that we do not serve your gods, nor will we worship the gold image that you have set up." Whew! Now, is that a standard bearer? Is that one who is immovable, not being shaken, said, "You know what? I don't care what comes down in the land. I am going to serve the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, and nobody's going to stop me." Yes! Yes! Guess what? He's expecting the same response from us. The same response. So the king is not warm and fuzzy here. He gets infuriated about it. He is so mad, and it's interesting what he chooses to do next just kind of puts the exclamation point on how mad he is. We're in verse 19. He says, "So then King Nebuchadnezzar, full of fury, and the expressions on his face changed towards Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and he spoke and commanded that they heat the furnace 7 more times than it is usually heated." That's pretty hot. "And he commanded certain," now this is a sad story, this part, "he commanded certain mighty men of valor who were in his army to bind Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and cast them into the fiery furnace." Now get this picture. He takes his mighty men and he has them bind them up. So they can't even move hardly. They walk in. But what happens? "Then these men were bound in their coats, their trousers and their turbans and their garments. They were all bound and were cast into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Therefore, because the king's command was urgent, the furnace exceedingly hot, the flame of the fire killed those men who took Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego." Now, get the picture. They're en route taking them, and they open the door, and the men fall in. But the point is, the guys that took them, they get engulfed, and they burn up. But the power and presence of God was already on the bound ones. And they just fall. It says right here, "And these three men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, fell down bound in the midst of the burning fiery furnace." Woo! Come on now. I mean, seriously, we've just now grasp the intensity of what's been spoken here. We do with the Bible stories, and it sounds so innocent, but this is big stuff. So in verse 24, then King Nebuchadnezzar was astonished. He's astonished because he sees his mighty men just go up in smoke. He's watching this scenario. And so he's astonished, and he rises in haste, and he spoke out to the counselors. Did we not cast three men bound in the middle of the fire? And then they answer, true, O king. And then he says in verse 25, look, he answered, I see four men loose, walking in the midst of the fire, and they are not hurt. And the form of the fourth is like the Son of God. Whew! God opened his spiritual eyes to see what was really happening here. I think he got his attention, do you think? So, in verse 28, it says, then Nebuchadnezzar went near the mouth of the burning fiery furnace. Now, that took a little bravery on his part since he just saw some guys be consumed as hot as that place was. But he goes right over there. And Shadrach and Meshach and Abednego, servants of the Most High God, come out. He says, come out and come here. Oh, my goodness. Can you imagine how amazed he was? I mean, he just couldn't believe his eyes. He could not believe his eyes. So he says, come here. Come out. Come here. And then Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego come out from the midst of the fire. And the satraps and the administrators and the governors and the king's counselors gathered together. They're like, let's go look at this. Let's go. Come on. Let's check this out. And they saw these men on whose body the fire had no power. The hair on their heads was not singed. Nor were their garments affected, and the smell of smoke wasn't even on them. Now, I'd say that's one big, bad, bona fide miracle. What do you think? Oh, my goodness. Woo. So what happens from there? What happens from there? All right. So Nebuchadnezzar turns around once more and says, in verse 28, blessed be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who sent his angel and delivered his servants who trusted in him, and they have frustrated the king's word and yielded their bodies that they should not serve nor worship any god except their own God. Wow. Do you hear his words there? He says, they have frustrated my words and yielded their bodies, basically giving me a demonstration that they're not going to serve or worship any god but their own God. And then he turns around and astounds them all again. And he says in verse 29, therefore, I make a decree that any people, nation, or language which speaks anything amiss against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego shall be cut in pieces, and their house shall be made an ash heap, because there is no other God who can deliver like this. Now, come on. Can the Lord turn the heart of a man like he can turn the mouth of a river here, or what? Woo-hoo! But the thing that's so awesome about it is he turns around and he says, well, this one's bigger than I am. And we all need to bow down to the one and only true living God. And he actually makes it a decree. So he turns the whole nation around and says, this is what we're going to do. From this time on, this is what we're going to do. And he's so adamant about it. He says, and if they don't, they're going to be cut in pieces. And their houses shall be made an ash heap. Because there is no other God. And who can deliver us like this? I'm telling you what, this is serious. So I don't know about you, but if I had heard about it and seen it, I would be walking a little bit of eggshells right now thinking, man, I'm going to find out who this God is, because I don't want to be cut up in pieces and made my home's made into an ash heap. Amen? So that's so exciting. Well, so what makes these men so special, and why were they spared? They stood up for God's principles, and they refused to bow. And that's a warning to us. Never, never, never bow to the God of this world, no matter what form or shape it comes in, whether it's Muslim, Islam, whoever comes, whoever tries to tell you, deny the name of Christ. This is a modern-day picture of how you don't deny the name of Christ. This is a modern-day heads up. You've got to stand firm. You've got to refuse to bow, and you can't do it. The truth will always prevail and bring great victory and freedom. It'll always prevail. It'll always bring victory. It'll always bring freedom. If you bow, you will burn. There's the key. You bow, you burn. You don't bow, you'll come through without any smoke or touch of the fire on you. It's awesome. You cannot compromise. But what you compromise to get, you will lose eventually. There's no compromise in God's kingdom. That's the key. No compromise, no gray area, no mixture. We have to be a people of truth and truth only. Amen? And well, I'm going to key in on 3:16 here. The king, when the king told them about, you know, he gave them the second chance, and I loved their expression. They said, "We don't have any need to answer you in the matter." They were really saying, "Let it be known to you, O king. Let it be known to you. Our God is able to deliver us out of that burning fiery furnace and out of your hand. We'll burn and lose our lives before we bow to you. There's only one true living God, and he can deliver us. But if he chooses not," I love that part. They knew where they were going. They knew who they belonged to. They weren't even moved. They weren't upset. Doesn't the word of God say in Revelation 12:11, that the enemy is defeated by the blood of the Lamb, the word of our testimony, and loving not our life unto death? Well, here it is. Here it is. Let it be known to you that we're still not going to bow, even if he doesn't deliver us. They weren't nervous. They weren't anxious. They didn't have to think about how they were, what they were doing. They took their stand, and they knew exactly what they were going to do. And they all, that's another thing here, they all were in agreement. Not one of them divided. Not one of them was anxious. Not one of them was fearful. They were all on the same page. And that's so important when it comes to unity, the place of the commanded blessing. Amen? So then we fast forward, and the king has a second dream. And so they call upon Daniel again, because, of course, his people couldn't do it again. So they call upon Daniel again. And in verse 18, we're now in chapter 4. That whole story is in 10 through 17, which I'm not going to take the time to read because we pretty much know it. This time it's the dream about him becoming this great big tree and then being cut off of the stump and then eating the grass. So it's the dream that God is speaking to him about him becoming so proud and so haughty that he's going to end up in the field like a wild animal. I would have paid attention to that one, I think. You know, the truth of the matter is pride is a very huge deception. And he got bit by that spirit of pride to the point where he couldn't even see it. It had become so familiar to him that that was what he walked in. He was totally deceived. And it's all he knew and all he walked in. He just was a boastful pride somebody. So they call upon Daniel. And we go down to Daniel 4, verse 18. Let's go to 4, verse 18. Because that, you know, he's telling Daniel the whole dream. So we go to 4:18, and Daniel, I mean, the king says to Daniel in 4:18, he says, "This dream I, King Nebuchadnezzar, have seen. Now you," this is, "you, Belteshazzar," meaning Daniel, "declare its interpretation, since all the wise men of my kingdom are not able to make it known. But you are able, for the spirit of the holy God is in you." So there it is again. He declares it and makes it known that the spirit of the holy God is in you, that excellent spirit. So then Daniel turns around and he explains the dream. And he tells him what the dream says. And then we're going to fast forward to verse 25 because we don't need to hear about the dream interpretation. Everybody knows the story. So we're down at 25, and it says, and if you don't online, please read it on your own time so that you can get this whole thing because it's so amazing. So he tells the whole dream of what it means, and then he says, he's going to tell him, and he says, the Most High rules in the kingdom of men, and it gives to it whomever he chooses. And so that was verse 25. He's showing the king that you think you got the world by the tail here, but you do not, because the one who put you in office is the one that rules the kingdom of men and gives it to whomever he chooses. So then he says in verse 26, and inasmuch as they gave the command to leave the stump and the roots of the tree, your kingdom shall be assured to you after you come to know that heaven rules. So he's basically saying, you're going to learn a lesson here. Therefore, O king, he tries to give the king a warning in verse 27. Therefore, O king, let my advice be acceptable to you. Break off your sins of being righteous and your iniquities by showing mercy to the poor, and perhaps there may be a lengthening of your prosperity. He was trying to show him, you're so proud, you're so haughty, you're all about you, and you're going to get cut down. So please heed my counsel and my warning. But unfortunately, the king did not. And in verse 28, it says, and all this came upon King Nebuchadnezzar. And at the end of 12 months, he was walking about the royal palace of Babylon, and the king spoke. And this is where he got cut down. Listen to what came out of his mouth. Ding, 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 ding. This is a no-go zone, guys. He says, is not this great Babylon that I have built for my royal dwelling by my mighty power and for the house of honor of my majesty? Woof. Woof. And while the word was still in the king's mouth, a voice fell from heaven. King Nebuchadnezzar, to you it is spoken, the kingdom has departed from you, and they shall drive you from men, and your dwelling shall be with the beasts of the field. They shall make you eat grass like the oxen. And seven times, do you hear that? Seven times. Do you remember what he was going to do to the three men? Seven times hotter furnace? Now we're back to the seven times shall pass over you until you know that the Most High rules in the kingdom of men and gives it to whomever he chooses. Wow. Ooh, wow. And it goes on in 33. That very hour, the word was fulfilled concerning Nebuchadnezzar. He was driven from men, and he ate grass like an oxen. His body was wet with dew of heaven till his hair had grown like eagle's feathers and his nails like bird's claws. 7 years being a beast in the field. Whoa. However, it's not over yet. Look at verse 34. At the end of the time, I, Nebuchadnezzar, lifted my eyes to heaven, and my understanding returned to me again. God opened his eyes. He had mercy on him and revealed heaven. And I blessed the Most High and praised and honored him who lives forever. For his dominion is an everlasting dominion, and his kingdom is from generation to generation. All the inhabitants of the earth are reputed as nothing. He does according to his will in the army of heaven. And amongst the inhabitants of the earth, no one can restrain his hand. I think he got the message. 7 years, though. Come on. 7 years. Or say to him, what have you done? At the same time as he saw, his reason returned to him. He says, at the same time, the reason returned to me. And for the glory of my kingdom, my honor and my splendor returned to me, and my counselors and nobles resorted to me, I was restored to my kingdom. Wasn't that kind of God? He could have let somebody else come in there and take over in those 7 years, but God kept everything on hold. Only God can do that because, listen, there's always men behind the scenes trying to connive and deceive and get that position. I mean, it's happened today. It's called the ladder, climbing the ladder and getting the position and getting, you know, that upper place, building your own kingdom. Hello? So here it says, I was restored to my kingdom, and excellent majesty was added to me. Excellent majesty was added to me. But now I, Nebuchadnezzar, praise and extol and honor the King of heaven, all of whose works are truth, and his ways justice. And those who walk in pride, he is able to put down. He is letting everybody know, this is where the problem was. I walked in pride. I walked in pride, but God was able to put me down. We know in Proverbs it said pride comes before destruction. Pride comes before destruction. Let's see where I am in my notes. Okay. So then we go into chapter 5. We're going to fast forward again. Now we have King Belshazzar. And he is Nebuchadnezzar's son. Now, remember, this king watched everything that his father did. It's not like this son was ignorant. Don't think he didn't see his father out grazing in the field for 7 years. But he comes into the throne. Let's see what time it is, because that clock's wrong. Oh, it is right. Okay, I thought it was wrong. Okay. So it's 12. Okay. All right, so it was wrong. Okay. Just want to make sure I'm within the timeline. So we have the new king who is Nebuchadnezzar's son, and he comes in, and he decides that he is going to have this great feast in chapter 5. And in this, he says, he commands them to bring, where I'm in verse 2 of 5, he commands them to bring the gold and the silver vessels from his father's, King Nebuchadnezzar's, which his father, King Nebuchadnezzar, had taken from the temple which had been in Jerusalem, that the king and his lords, his wives and his concubines, might drink from them. Now, here is where he overstepped. Even his father didn't go that far. These were vessels of gold and silver from the house of God, the temple of God. And so he decides in his haughtiness and his feasting that he's going to go do something his father didn't even do. So he calls for these vessels to come. And then they brought them. And they had taken them from the temple of the house of God, which had been in Jerusalem, and the king and his lords and his wives and his concubines, and they all drank from them. So what did they do? They defiled the vessels of God in his kingdom. And they drank wine, and they praised the gods of gold and silver and bronze, iron and wood and stone. In that same hour, I love God's amazing creative ways. In that same hour, verse 5, the finger of a man's hand appeared and wrote opposite the lampstand on the plaster of the wall of the king's palace. Now, the king saw the part of the hand that wrote. Then the king's countenance changed. I think that got his attention. And it says, and his thoughts troubled him. So the joints of his hips were loosened. I'm telling you what, it's very descriptive. His bones were shaking all of a sudden, and his knees were knocking against each other. Do you think the fear of the Lord came upon him? I think so. And the king cries aloud to bring the astrologers and the Chaldeans and the soothsayers, and the king spoke, saying to the wise men of Babylon. Here we are again. History repeating itself. He calls upon his what he thinks are mighty men. And he says, whoever reads the writing and tells me the interpretation shall be clothed with purple and have a chain of gold around his neck. And he shall be the third ruler in the kingdom. Now all the king's wise men came, but they could not read the writing or make known to the king the interpretation. Oh my goodness. Do you see a little generational iniquity happening here where the sins of the fathers come down to the third and fourth generations? I think we're seeing it prove out. So the king was very troubled, and his countenance was changed, and his lords were all astonished. Now, here we have a smart queen. The queen shows up in verse 10. The queen, because of the words the king and his lords came to the banquet hall, because of those words, and the queen spoke, saying, O king, live forever. Do not let your thoughts trouble you, nor let your countenance change. And she remembers Daniel. Verse 15, there is a man in your kingdom in whom the spirit of the holy God dwells in. And in the days of your father, light and understanding and wisdom, like the wisdom of the gods, were found in him. And King Nebuchadnezzar, your father the king, he was reminding him, made him chief of the magicians, the astrologers, and the Chaldeans, and the soothsayers. So inasmuch as an excellent spirit, there's that excellent spirit, knowledge, understanding, interpreting dreams, solving riddles, and explaining enigmas were found in this Daniel, whom the king named Belshazzar, now let Daniel be called, and he will give the interpretation. She had seen it. She had witnessed it. She was the wise one of the kingdom. So Daniel was brought before them. Daniel's brought before them, and let's see, where am I? So Daniel comes in, and he sees it, and he gives the interpretation. So down in verse 17, he says to the king, because the king, again, is bartering with him, saying, if you do this, I'll give you the purple robe, I'll give you gold around your neck, I'll let you be the third of the kingdom. And Daniel answers him. He is not enticed. He is not even interested in what the king has to offer. And he says, let your gifts be for yourself. I love that. There was nothing on this earth that could entice Daniel. He knew what mattered. He knew where riches were, and they were in his king. King of kings and Lord of lords. He says, let your riches be for yourself. Give your rewards to another. Yet I will read the writing to the king and make known to him the interpretation. And he goes on to say, O king, the Most High God gave Nebuchadnezzar your father a kingdom and a majesty and glory and honor. And because of the majesty that he gave him, all the people, the nations, the languages, trembled and feared before him. Whomever he wished, he executed. Whomever he wished, he kept alive. And whoever he wished, he set up. And whomever he wished, he put down. So he was letting his son know, he was letting this king know, the son of Nebuchadnezzar, how his father went about and did his business. He was kind of like giving him a little education. Apparently you didn't get the memo, so let me tell you how it worked. And he says in verse 20, but when his heart was lifted up, he's talking about his father again, when his heart was lifted up and his spirit was hardened in pride, he was disposed from the kingly throne and he took the glory from him. And then he was driven from the sons of men and his heart was made like beasts and his dwelling was with the wild donkeys. And they fed him and gave him grass, and his body was wet with dew until he knew the Most High God rules in the kingdom of men and appoints whoever over it, whoever he chooses. But then he didn't point his finger, but he was pointing his finger. He says, but you, his son, Belshazzar, have not humbled your heart, although you knew all of this. So he calls him on it. Although you knew all of this. You have lifted yourself up against the Lord of heaven. They have brought the vessels of his house before you, and you and your lords, your wives, and your concubines have drank wine from them. And you have praised the gods of silver and gold, bronze and iron, wood and stone, which do not see or hear or know, and the God who holds your breath in his hands and owns all your ways, you have not glorified. Then the fingers of the hand were sent from him, and this writing was written. Wow. So he lets him know your pride, your haughtiness, your defilement of the God, King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and wanting all that praise and worship for your gods has cost you your breath and even your life. So then he says, 25, this is the inscription that was written. Mene, mene, tekel, Asherah. I probably butchered that. And the meaning is, the interpretation of each is this. Mene, God has numbered your kingdom and finished it. Tekel, you have been weighed in the balances and found wanting. Perez, your kingdom has been divided and given to the Medes and the Persians. And then Belshazzar gave the command, and they clothed Daniel with purple and put a chain of gold around his neck and made a proclamation concerning him that he should be the third ruler in the kingdom. And then in verse 30 it says, that very night Belshazzar, king of the Chaldeans, was slain. And Darius the Mede received the kingdom, being about 62 years old. So, interesting. He spoke it, and Daniel became that third ruler, and boom. All of a sudden, the guy gets slain. So, you think God's a little serious about don't defile the house of God, or even the things of the house of God? Oh, my goodness. My. So, then we fast forward again. Let's go to chapter 6. I'm showing you how the enemy of this world wants to cut us off, how the enemy of this world wants to deceive us, and how he's trying to show us that we can't be who God's called us to be. So then we fast forward and we go to chapter 6. And in chapter 6, the people that are serving King Darius, I think it's Darius. Yes, I just said that. Yeah, he takes over. So then his wise men around him are very jealous of Daniel. They're like, you know what, guys? It isn't. Nothing can stop this man. He will do no wrong. They try to check him out. They try to find fault with him. But it says down here in verse 3 of chapter 6, it says, in 2 it says, so that the king would suffer no loss. I mean, this was, Daniel was one that they might, that the satraps might give account to them so that the king would not suffer any loss. So that was Daniel's job. And then Daniel distinguished himself above the governors and satraps, and because of an excellent spirit was seen in him, and the king gave thought to setting him over the whole realm. So these governors and satraps sought to find some charge against Daniel concerning the kingdom, but they could find no charge. Let it be known of us that we have no charge found in us, that we will not deceive God, that we will not do something for our own gain, that we will not walk in any mixture or any compromise. Let it be said of us. Amen? So it goes on to say, but they found no charge or fault because he was faithful. Nor was there any error or fault found in him. So then these three men said, now this is very interesting. Now this has happened and we've seen it in Christendom today. So they say, we shall not find any charge against this Daniel unless we find it against him concerning the law of his God. Wow. They thought they were going to outwit Daniel. So they do this sneaky thing, and they connive the king to turn around and say to the king. They go to the king, and they say, King Darius, live forever. All the governors of the kingdoms and the administrators and the satraps and the counselors and the advisors have consulted together. Do you see that they banded together and plotted against Daniel here? I mean, they even announced it to the king, but the king wasn't too swift because he didn't pick up on it. He says, we've established a royal statute and to make a firm decree that whoever petitions any god or man for 30 days, except you, O king, shall be cast down into the den of lions. And now, O king, establish the decree and sign the writing so that it cannot be changed according to the law of the Medes and the Persians, which does not alter. Therefore, King Darius signed the written decree. Now, this was a new king and a new regime, and it was according to the Medes and the Persians, and it couldn't be taken back, in other words. And so Daniel goes on about his business. Business as usual. So there he is in verse 10. Daniel knew that the writing was signed, but he went home. And in his upper room, with his windows wide open towards Jerusalem, he knelt down on his knees 3 times a day and prayed and gave thanks before God, as was his custom since the early days. He didn't change. He says, here we go again. God, you are my God. I'm not afraid. I'm going to do what you called me to do, and I'm not going to be moved. Now, these men assembled and found Daniel praying. Surprise! Do you think they were waiting? I think so. Do you think they were listening and watching, even with, you know? Oh, yeah, they were. So what do? They went before the king and spoke concerning the king's decree. Have you not signed a decree that every man who petitions any god or man within 30 days except you, O king, shall be cast into the lion's den? The king answered them, the thing is true according to the law of the Medes and the Persians, which does not alter. So then they answered and they said to the king, well, that Daniel, who is one of the captives from Judah, does not show due regard for you, O king, or the decree that you have signed, but makes his petition 3 times a day. And the king, when he heard these words, note the king's reaction. The king, when he heard these words, was greatly displeased within himself and set his heart on Daniel to deliver him. Whoa. He was so undone over what he just heard. He's like, what can I do? What can I do? What can I do? So he sets his heart on trying to deliver him. And he labored till the going down of the sun to deliver him. He got busy. Then, here they come. Then those men approached the king and said to the king, know, O king, that it is the law of the Medes and the Persians that no decree or statute which the king establishes may be changed. Oh, they knew they had him over a barrel. It was a trick. It was a plan. It was a scheme. And he was stuck. So verse 16, the king gave the demand. They brought Daniel and cast him into the den of lions. But the king spoke, saying to Daniel, listen to his heart for Daniel. This so touched me. They had a relationship. He truly loved Daniel. He was so undone that he had done this because he had not walked in wisdom and he was ignorant to their scheme. He was so undone, he made it a point to say to Daniel in verse 16b. And now this is awesome what he says. Your God, whom you serve continually, he will deliver you. Now, do you hear what goes out of his mouth? And do you hear what God's going to do now? Because he's speaking of the one true living God, and he's prophesying over Daniel. The one true God, the one you serve continually, he will deliver you. Woo! Come on. Then a stone was brought and laid on the mouth of the den. Now, this is the king's, you know, seal. The king sealed it with his own signet ring and with the signets of his lords, that the purpose concerning Daniel might not be changed. He had to go through with what had been decreed. Verse 18. Now the king went to his palace and he spent the night fasting. He did what? The king spent the night fasting. Come on. That's unheard of. This is not a custom of their land. This is not a custom of those people. But he knew what Daniel did. He knew what Daniel did in order to get the answer for the interpretation. Trust me, the word was out of the customs of Daniel. He spent the night fasting. No magicians were brought before him, and also his sleep went from him. He was up all night long. Now, do you recognize how God had this king unknowingly on the first watch, the second watch, the third watch, the fourth watch on Daniel's behalf? This is unheard of. He didn't even know what was going on, but his posture, his concern, he was actually standing in the gap of prayer for Daniel and wasn't even aware of it. Come on. So exciting. So then the king arose very early in the morning, and he went in haste. He runs to the lion's den. And when he came to the den, he cries out with a lamenting voice to Daniel. The king spoke, saying to Daniel, Daniel, servant of the living God, has your God, whom you serve continually, been able to deliver you from the lions? Woo! And then Daniel says to the king, Oh, king, live forever. My God sent his angel and shut the lions' mouths so that they have not hurt me, because I was found innocent before him. And also, O king, I have done no wrong before you. I love how he takes both of those positions and says, I've done no wrong before my God, but as your subject, I have done no wrong before you, king. He was confident that he was innocent. And I love that. So now the king, can you just imagine this king after staying awake all night, knowing he blew it, knowing that he had to follow through because of the trickery? Can you imagine how excited he is? It says, now the king was exceedingly glad for him and commanded that they should take Daniel up out of the den. And so Daniel was taken up out of the den, and no injury whatsoever was found on him, because he believed in his God. And then the king commands that they bring those men who had accused Daniel. Now, this is the sad part. And not only cast them into the den of lions, but their children and their wives. And the lions, listen to how this played out. And the lions overpowered them and broke their bones in pieces before they ever came to the bottom of the den. Now, can you put this in perspective? Here we got Daniel walking around the entire night. These lions were kept from eating on purpose in order to devour anyone who went against the king's rule, and they were going to be their breakfast, lunch, and dinner. But those lions sat there all night and watched Daniel walk around the lions all night long, yet their mouths were bound shut. Do you think those lions were teased a little bit? Just a little? Come on. So here it says that when they threw the men and the children into the den, that their bones were broken in pieces before they even got to the bottom. I mean, I don't know how many lions in there, but their mouths were open and they caught them in the air. I mean, that's really the picture. Oh, my goodness. Oh, my goodness. So what is the key to the story? Do not ever compromise. Do not ever bow to another guy. God, do not ever put your faith on the line of compromise, mixture, or fear of man. That's it. Do not walk in the fear of man. Daniel, Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego did not walk in the fear of God. I mean, in the fear of man. The word says, I think it's in Proverbs 25, or no, it's 29:25. The fear of man brings a snare, but those who trust in the Lord are safe. Well, here it played out on all of these things. Because they feared the Lord their God, they remained safe. And so we, as a people of God, have to come up to be modern Daniels today, because we are in a modern day Babylon. The enemy does not play fair. He is using the wealth. He's using the political regime. Again, it was another political regime. He is using the players, if you will, the players in this kingdom that we live in here on this earth to come against us, to try to destroy us, to try to take us out, to try to say, we rule over you. But just as we saw an amazing display with our election, when the people of God who are called by my name, humble themselves and pray, according to 2 Chronicles 7:14. 7:14. When we band together as a body and do what is right in the sight of God, God will move heaven and earth, and he will move kingdoms out of the way, and his kingdom will be established on earth as it is in heaven. So our part is to know this word. Daniel, it says in the beginning that he was familiar with the instructions of the word and knew the ways of God. And he was not willing to do it any other way. But that's where our part comes in. If we don't know the words of this book, then we're going to falter easily, because as the expression goes, we won't have a leg to stand on. We won't have a leg to stand on, and we won't stay anchored to the rock. The only way our anchor holds, the anchor of you that changed you to the anchor of the rock, which is that sure anchor that we're not going to be moved, we're not going to be cut off, is this word. The word became flesh and dwelt amongst us. The word is our surety. It's our blessed assurance. As we eat the word, drink the word, live the word, it will keep us anchored to the rock, and we will not be moved. The word is very clear. He says, nothing can separate you from my love. Nothing. Nothing can snatch you out of my hand. But he also says in John 10 that the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy, but I have come to give you life and life abundantly. He also says in that same chapter that my sheep know my voice, and no other voice will they listen to. How did Daniel stand? How did Shadrach and Abednego, they kind of run together after a while. How did they stand? They knew their God, they knew the voice of their God, and they knew what the word of God said. They knew it. Come on, they were Hebrew boys. When you're a Hebrew child, you get the talith put in you starting from the age of 3. And you have to know all 5 books, the first 5 books of the Bible. They knew what the word of God said. They knew who their God was. And they weren't willing to compromise. And in that first five books, they knew the blessings of Abraham. They knew that their blessings were going to be like as many as the stars, just like Abraham's. They knew the promise. They knew it. And they didn't waver from it. They didn't waver from it. We have the whole chapter 11, the faith chapter in Hebrews. It's a whole chapter on how this one stood and didn't waver, how that one stood and didn't waver, how this one was listed in the book because they followed God and they trusted him. Even though they didn't receive the promise, they didn't waver. They did not waver. So we have this great cloud of witnesses that are up there cheering each one of us on. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We have this great cloud of witnesses cheering each one of us on, saying, go, go, go. Represent my son well. I mean, their king well. I'm thinking they represent the King of Kings well. Represent Christ well. You can do it. We did it. You got even more than we had. You have the Spirit of the living God living in you. You have the New Testament. They didn't. We've got the stories. We've got the stories, and we see where Jesus walked, and we see what Jesus did. We have the testament. We have no excuse to not believe. That's really what it comes down to. So I just encourage each and every one of you to get so fired up for the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, what he has done, what he still can do, and what he wants to do for you and your families. This is not a time to grow faint or weary. This is a time where he is saying, come up here, Revelation chapter 4, when he's talking to John, come up here, let me show you what I'm about. Come up higher. Let me show you. He wants us to see heaven's view and operate out of that spirit realm. Because, see, if we stay here in the carnality of the realm we live in and only see with our carnal eyes and not with our spirit eyes, the spirit of your heart being enlightened, we will get taken out, because there's a plan in the end days for the enemy to wear out the saints. And part of his wearing out the saints is getting them busy. So busy that they don't have time for intimacy. They don't have time to go to the secret place. They don't have time to hang out with God. and remember what he's done. And remember who he really is. And remember what he can do. So I just encourage each one of you, this is not an hour to take anything for granted. We have to stay sharp. We have to stay tuned. We have to stay in line. So we speak divine alignment. We speak freedom over you, that you can walk in freedom as you stay in line with the word. This is the plumb line. As we stay in alignment and walk the plumb line of the word and stay away from the ways of the world, like we said in the beginning, the delicacies of the world, which will dim and overtake your sensitivity and intimacy with Christ, which will cause you to be dull of heart, dull of hearing, dull of seeing. That's the enemy's plan, to take you out so that you can't stay tuned. So, Lord, I just thank you for this message. I pray that the words of life that I spoke today would grasp us in a deeper way, that we would understand even greater from this message the things that we haven't before. This is not just a children's Bible story. This is so much more. This is the word of the Most High God, and he is just the same yesterday, today, and forever. And you want a people who will walk the straight line, who will, that bloodline is drawn beside us. And we need both feet on that side of the bloodline. We cannot have one foot in the world and one foot in the kingdom of God, because that means there's a fence between us and we built it and we cannot sit on the fence. So Lord, let your blessing of conviction come upon each one of us today, that we get both feet on the side of the bloodline that's drawn before us, and we not waver, we not cross that bloodline, we not dare give the enemy an inch so that he can take us out. Because he is a roaring lion, a toothless roaring lion, just waiting to devour us and to find us out. He is ruthless. He doesn't play fair, and he doesn't care. He just has one plan, and that is to destroy us. And so, Lord, let us be wise like Daniel. Let us walk in the wisdom of Daniel. Let us walk in the knowledge of the Lord. Let us walk in an excellent spirit, the spirit of the holy living God that dwells within us. And let us be a true walk and talk and example of Jesus Christ today as an ambassador who, when they see us, they'll know what kingdom we serve. When they see us, they'll hear the truth, and the truth will set them free. When they listen to our counsel, they'll know it's the Spirit of God speaking from heaven on earth into them. Let the light of us, Christ in us, go forth, and let the knowledge of the Lord in us be the glory which we give away to each and every one that is around us. And let us raise our children up in the fear and admonition of God. Let us be people who walk in the true fear of God and will no longer be watered down, complacent, mediocre, walk in mediocrity, or mixture or compromise. But let us be the real thing, Christ in us, the hope of glory, the people of God who are known for truth and known to be like Christ. And we just thank you for that, Father God, right now. In the name of Jesus, seal the word, bless that word, water it, fertilize it, bring it forth that it may build great trees and fruit trees and fruit that can be eaten, and give it away, and let it have a multiplication process in all of our lives. Let this truth go on and on and on. Let us stand on Deuteronomy 1:11, that the blessings of Abraham will be multiplied 1,000 times to us and all generations in our lives, in Jesus Christ's holy name. Amen. Whew. All righty. So, we're few, but we're mighty, and we're going forth, right? We're going forth. If anybody needs prayer, you know we're always up here for it, but otherwise you're dismissed, and we even beat the children today. How about that? We got done before the king's kids. Hallelujah. All righty. Thank you so much.